You're listening to When Christians Speak Online Talk Radio, broadcasting out of the Washington, D.C. metropolitan area. Today's voice crying out in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord. When Christians Speak is dedicated to lifting up the name of Christ Jesus and spreading the good news.
Nature fights to dominate. My spirit man is poised and locked in battle. With the carnal side of me, I've grown to hate. The trumpet of my prayer lay toward heaven, a voice of desperation, hear my cry. Lord, strengthen me that I might not yield myself to sin. So keep your righteous banner lifted high. Lord, I hunger for
challenge to change, where transformation begins with you. Change appears to be one of the biggest hindrances to growth and relationships that I have encountered while in ministry. Our focus is usually on someone else and what they have done or are doing to us, instead of us being accountable to God and making sure we're not a stumbling block to ourselves or others. Challenge to change is about us taking personal responsibility for our Christian walk as we face challenges and issues and how to overcome them through biblical tools and techniques that we will discuss on this show. Everything about this show is encompassed in us depending on the Holy Spirit to edify, enrich, and transform lives by introducing individuals to a personal encounter with God's unconditional love. That is where real transformation begins and ends.
Passive aggressive. A persistent pattern of communicating your feelings in a roundabout way rather than candidly stating them. It appears to fulfill the needs and wishes of others, but in fact passively defies them, typically becoming upset and hostile. Today, Pastor Paul will be looking at passive-aggressive behavior in today's series on control.
Father, I come before your throne, washed in the blood of Jesus. I thank you for giving me the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might. Make me a quick understanding so I do not judge by what I see with my eyes or hear with my ears, but by what your Holy Spirit reveals to me. We thank you, Jesus, for your presence, and I ask you to be Lord over this ministry and all that is done here. We ask you, Holy Spirit, to anoint this time of prayer and ministry. We claim the blood of Jesus over this session for our protection. We proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord here and that this is holy ground. We take authority in the name of Jesus and the power of his blood and word and command all evil spirits to leave this property now. We claim this room sealed in the name and authority of Jesus. We bind and forbid any evil spirits on the outside from having any knowledge or influence in this room. We thank you that the battle is the Lord's, but the victory is ours. We thank you that you have the right to adjust, shift, change, move, do whatever is necessary to bring forth your glory, your power, your might, your dominion, your rest, your peace, your increase, your victory in every area of our lives. And we call it manifested right now in Jesus' name. And all in agreement say, amen. Amen. So which side are we starting on today? So what we've been talking about? Who's the boss? Talking about control. Let's read these together, Eurasia. I'll just let you click. Control begins where trust is absent. Okay, let's go ahead to the next one. We're going to read these in unison. Trust God from the bottom of your heart. Don't try to figure out everything on your own. Listen for God's voice in everything you do, everywhere you go. He's the one who will keep you on track. Don't assume that you know it all. Run to God. Run from evil. Your body will glow with health, and your very bones will vibrate with life. Watch out for people who try to dazzle you with big words and intellectual double talk. They want to drag you off into endless arguments that never amount to anything. They spread their ideas through the empty traditions of human beings and the empty superstitions of spiritual beings. But that's not the way of Christ. Everything of God gets expressed in Him, so you can see and hear Him clearly. You don't need a telescope, a microscope, or a horoscope to realize the fullness of Christ and the emptiness of the universe without Him. When you come to Him, the full comes together for you too. His power extends over everything. Now, I want you to get a clear picture that the Holy Spirit is the teacher. So therefore, He knows what this body is going through. So if I stay on a subject, it's because the Holy Spirit says stay there. If I move to another subject, that means the Holy Spirit says this is what's going on now. So don't take it personal if the Holy Spirit directs the word into your area of concern. Everybody got that? Yeah. So I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about the Spirit that says something is going on and let's address it. You got it? So if I do one series one day and go on to something else, that means the Holy Spirit says, done, I did what I needed to do. So control, He says, we got a little issue with. Okay? So remember we talked about withholding approval. How many of you all got something out of skits last week? Yeah, it was pretty cool. So withholding approval is what? Just shout it out to me. It's what? What's withholding approval? Go ahead and mic it.
Praise what praise is due.
Ooh, not giving praise what praise is due. All right. Unteachable. What does that look like? Raise your hand. Got one behind.
Is someone like you trying to train someone or something like that?
And
instead of going by what you tell them to do, they do it on their own.
Okay, do it their way.
Different way.
Okay, all right. I'm going to move to the next one. Pride. Anybody got an answer for pride? What does pride look like? Got one over here? What does pride look like?
I can do that in my own power. Ooh. I don't need God's help.
Okay, I can do that in my own power. I don't need God's help. Easily offended. Who want to take that one? We know there's none of y'all. What's easily offended? I got one thing.
Anything that you say to a person or somebody says to you.
Okay.
It doesn't matter how it is, what was said, okay. They could say it happy, okay. And you take it offensively.
Okay, all right. What about victim mentality? Who wants to take that one? What does that look like? You got one right here?
The woe is me syndrome.
Woe is me syndrome.
Yes.
Everything is about you.
Yes.
Okay.
All right. It's me.
Okay. It's me. She's shaking her head like she knows somebody like that. All right, what about jealousy? What does that look like?
It's like you see someone with something and you already have, like if you have a car or something like that, and there's nothing wrong with your car.
Okay.
But still you want that other person's car.
Okay, you want the other person's car. Okay, all right. Can I get a drum roll? Ready? 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 Everybody say passive? Yes. Aggressive. Y'all ready to go there?
Yeah.
Okay, let's go. You ready, Sharon? Let me tell you now, this thing get ugly. I'm going to ask you to do two things today. I'm going to ask you to look forward in you. Y'all go ahead and write it down. Look forward in you and watch out for it in them. You know I won't get through this today, right? So, but what I will tell you is going to cause you to reevaluate a lot of your relationships. Because when you find out who this is connected to, anyway, all right, passive aggressive. Mayo Clinic says, somebody with a mic, Rosalyn, would you mind reading that for me?
A persistent pattern of communicating your feelings in a roundabout way rather than candidly stating them.
All right, I see a couple of snickers. What does that mean? Candy, what are you laughing about? Give her the mic.
I encounter this on a regular basis with a particular person.
Okay.
And they won't say exactly what it is that's bothering them.
But, okay.
And then they will get flustered or upset when I tell them to be direct.
Okay.
And they never come to the conclusion of what it is they're actually saying until they are way up here angry.
Okay.
And then it comes out real ugly.
Okay. All right. So they get to the place where they're really, really angry, and then it comes out. Okay? Now, did they say that's Paul Morgan's definition? Okay, all right, okay. All right. Audrey, can you read the National Institute of Health?
It appears to fulfill the needs and wishes of others, but in fact passively defies them, typically becoming upset and hostile.
So what is it that you need? What is it that you need? You ask for what you need, and then what do you get? It appears as if they're giving you what you need. But in reality, they are extremely hostile. Now, I want you to key in on the thing that most of the time, the upset and hostile part doesn't show up until it boils. Okay? You follow me? Y'all with me? Y'all know anybody like this? Yes, I'm not going to start meddling first. I got to ease in. I can't go straight in. All right? Let's look at some characteristics. Not being straightforward about their true feelings or beliefs, but rather covering them. What does that mean? I got you, Chill.
You say you like something.
Okay.
But you actually hate it.
Ah, you say you like it, but you actually hate
it. That was all right. Okay. That was nice. With the little, obviously not cute.
Okay. She said claws. You got claws out. All right, what else? Well, let me ask you, how have you seen this play in your life? The person is not being straightforward about their true feelings or beliefs, but rather they cover them. How have you seen that? I got Tyrone. How have you seen that?
I have four sisters.
Okay.
And four half sisters. So I do run into the problem when they say, well, do you like this? Or how I look in this, you know? And sometimes I just can't tell them, you know?
Okay. All right.
Okay.
So what you do, Tyrone? How you get out of that?
I just say, you look nice.
Okay. All right. Hazel, hold on 1 second. Mike coming your way. Not being straightforward about their true feelings or beliefs, but rather covering them.
For me personally, it's about, you know, someone that I know that has, you know, hurt me in my life, growing up, childhood, whatever it may be.
Okay.
And my still dealing with them.
Okay.
And but being uncomfortable around them because I can't tell them. I'm afraid to tell them you've hurt me.
Gotcha. Okay. I appreciate your honesty. And that'll probably come up next week. You got one right here. And y'all can switch sides too. If you see her on this side, jump over. We don't have no territory, all right?
Sometimes you have that opportunity to tell the truth,
okay?
But based on your experience with that person, okay. You know they would get upset if you told them the truth. So you try to soften it.
Okay, all right. Y'all been reading my PowerPoint. That's coming up soon, okay? An effort to avoid conflict out of a personal fear of consequence. Hazel, you just said that. Personal fear of consequence or even expressing any difference of opinion. What does that mean? I got it. Mike coming your way. So your history or the data or the profile shows that if I have a difference of opinion, I know one person. You can't say that a movie's objective. Yeah. You know, you can have one person put it 2 stars and you have one person put it 5. Why are you going to argue with somebody about the movie? Well, did you like the movie? No, I thought it was slow. But what do you mean slow? It was a good movie. Well, it was a good movie to you. I didn't like it. But around that person, for me, it's 3 times. After the 3rd time, they asked me about the movie. What do you think? And I just let them just keep on talking about it. I'm glad you liked it. Okay, go ahead.
Well, the second point I said is people who go with the status quo.
Okay.
And they're very dangerous.
All right, what does that mean? Status quo.
Because you want to fit in so bad
that
you're scared to be yourself. And in the end, that's always a bad thing.
Always a bad thing.
That never works out.
Because they're good at being who they are. You challenge being who you are until you know who he made you. Has a history of being disregarded or even abused if they did not follow the lead of those in authority. That's basically what Hazel just said. Notice the word history. Meaning that this didn't happen 1 time, it didn't happen 2 times, didn't happen 3 times, but it's a happening. It keeps going on. So passive-aggressively, you have to figure out a way to get back at them. You got to figure out a way to do it a different way, because if you are honest with them, then it's not going to be pretty. Follow me? This is a form of control. If I can't be who I am with you, that is a form of control. If you use passive aggressive to get back at someone, that is a form of control. And you are going to start to see how that relationship is impacting you as we go forth in it.
Passive aggressive tactic that people who feel like they don't have power generally use?
Oh, yeah.
Because they have to do stuff behind the scenes?
They have to do it behind the scenes. Okay. Let me see, can I give you a couple examples of passive aggressive before we move forward? Yes, ma'am.
Isn't that a sign of insecurity, too?
Yep, that's one of the cores. One of the cores of passive aggressive is insecurity attached to inadequacy.
Okay.
All right. Most of the time, person that's passive aggressive is very close to you. So let me give you an example of passive aggressive. Now, Jazz knows that I need this coat because I got to go on stage. All right, so you're going to pull the sleeve. You're going to make sure the sleeve is messed up. Now, she knows I'm running behind her. I got to get up on the stage because I got to make this announcement. I got to do this presentation. Passive aggressive. Okay, thanks. What happened to this lead? She pulled it inside out so that when I got up here, I would have to stop in front of everybody, try to figure out what's wrong with the sleeve. Everybody's looking, everybody's watching, and then I have to do that. And what does that make me look like? I don't know what I'm doing. I wasn't prepared. I wasn't organized. So see how subtle that was? She was there for me. She handed me the coat, but she made sure that there was a wardrobe malfunction, okay? But to everybody that's here, it looked like she did her job. You follow me? Somebody give me a set of keys. These were the ones that the Holy Spirit woke me up this morning about 4 o'clock. So I just want to let y'all know, okay? Now, how many of y'all put the keys in a certain place? Okay, all right? So Mary, you come on up for a second. Mary and I together, and where are you normally put the keys? Just pick a place right here. She normally put the keys right there. But I'm upset with Mary. And I know she has an important appointment today. And, well, we don't want to hide the keys. Put them right here. Well, I got to put them on the seat because it has to be almost similar to her area. Okay? So now I know she has a job interview today, and it's important. But last night I got mad at her, and I didn't resolve that issue. So when Marion looks for her keys that are normally right there, where are her keys at? And she asked me, honey, say, honey, where are the keys?
Where are the keys?
Didn't you put them right there? Huh? Didn't you put them right there? Well, I'll help you look out if I brush my teeth. So, honey, guess what? While I was brushing my teeth, I happened to find them over here. Now, did I help her? What did it appear? I found her keys. It appeared as if I helped her. Okay, you see? You see how this works? Thank you, ma'am. I know you're late for the interview. And then when she comes back, she said, I didn't get the job because I showed up late. And then what do? I go, oh, and then what do? I comfort her. Write this thing down. It's the person close to you. It's wrong. It get ugly. It get uglier. Wait a minute now. You know better.
But do you see how much effort it took for you to do that? When you could have just did the right thing, it'd have been about 15 minutes off of whatever it was you just did.
But write this down.
She could have got the right thing
to them is
you.
What they just did.
What you say?
The right thing to them is what they just did. You said if you could have just did the right thing, but the right thing to them is what they just did. The only reason we do things is because it works. Hold on. Back up. Don't shotgun blast me. Okay, just hold on. We're talking about behavior that people do. You know that it's wrong, but they think it's right. Period. I can't answer any clearer than that. We only do behavior because we think it works. Give me a mic right here. Hold on one sec. Just pass it down. And I got somebody right here. Okay.
I'd like to know, why do you feel that it was right?
Because they did it.
Because they did
it. We only do what we do because we say it works.
But it didn't work.
It worked for him. He made sure his wife didn't get the job. See, write this down. You guys trying to see it through how you would do. We're not talking about how you would do it. We're talking about how people control you. Y'all keep saying it's terrible, but it's real. Okay, hold on. I got a couple mics over here. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
I don't know if this is an example or not, but I'm going to put it out there.
Okay, go ahead. Throw it out there. Y'all listen?
A couple of months.
Don't put your hands down until these two talk. Then we'll get you. Go ahead.
A couple of months ago, okay. Well, not even a couple of months, but maybe a month and a half ago, I had asked Kim to do something for me.
Okay.
And she's laughing. Anyway, she didn't complete it.
Okay.
Okay. And I was insecure.
Okay.
Which is one of the cores.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I didn't realize that until today.
Yeah.
Well, yes, I did. Didn't I, Kim? Okay. Yeah. Anyway, so my method of dealing with things when people disappoint me or whatever or make me mad is to just stop speaking to them.
Okay. All right.
And so I went, almost 2 weeks.
2 weeks, okay.
And didn't speak to her. And we live in a very small apartment complex. It's it's the row.
Okay.
And Kim would try to speak to me, and I would be like, hey, you know.
Okay.
Real short and abrupt.
Okay.
And anyway, I thought because that's normal behavior for me that you know, again, you know, I was trying to control her.
You thought it was what kind of behavior?
It was normal behavior for me.
Okay.
Based on my history.
Okay. Right.
That I, you know, people make me mad, I just stop speaking to them.
Okay.
Instead of dealing with it.
Okay.
Appreciate it. Head on.
Yep. That was passive aggressive. Straight up. All right. I got one here. Somebody hear the mic back here. Yeah. Okay, cool.
Can a person, how can I put it, take pleasure?
Oh, yeah.
In being?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. They throw a party. Now, remember, I didn't come up with these. Y'all got an issue? Y'all need to take it up with him. He woke me up at 4 o'clock. He said, give these examples. Go ahead, Will.
Everybody is, well, not everybody, but a lot of people are saying, well, that's just not right. It's so not. What causes people to become passive aggressive?
Okay. All right, so there's two main cores. Number one is inadequacy. And number two is fear. So I'm afraid of what our relationship will be like, what the action will look like. So I am afraid. So just put fear, and I'll get to that in a couple weeks. So fear and inadequacy are the two cores. Yeah. So it comes from that those two. So let's say, for example, let me just give you a quick definition. So if Marian Anderson gets the job, then she makes more money than me, and so there. You said that out loud. She makes more money than me, so now I'm inadequate because I didn't supply. Now I'm threatened. I have the fear that whatever control I had over her, now she has over me. So I have to appear to want her to get the job. She can't contain herself back there. So I have to appear as if I want her to have the job, but really I'm threatened by her getting it. So it's not even about her. It's about my fear and my feelings of inadequacy. So I'll get more in detail. All right, who else? Yes, ma'am. Are you good? You got you? Okay. Who else? You got right here and then over here.
Well, it seems like someone that's exhibiting passive aggressiveness gets a lot of self-satisfaction, so they think.
Yeah.
I mean, it's misguided, but they get some self-satisfaction, like, mm-hmm, I told you.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
You know.
Interesting, Pastor, that you said it that way, and Pastor Lat used me for the example, because that's what I felt when I walked out of the job interview, that the guy felt like I was more qualified than he was.
Okay.
And he said that in several ways.
Okay. All right. So I have the ability, so I'm going to stop the job. But no, that's what he thought he did.
Pastor, I had a comment okay. to make. You said that people are doing it to us. People are doing it to us. And we don't even realize.
Nope.
That's deep.
That's real deep. That's why I'm exposing it. Because people don't even realize. That's why y'all getting so mad. Remember when I taught on forgiveness first time? About forgiving people? At the old church, they got mad, Megan. I'm telling you, they got mad. I thought I'd have to get an escort out the building. I'm serious. Y'all remember the old church? How many of y'all was at the old church? Yes, sir, but I'm telling you, they got mad. Who? Somebody hear the mic? Yes, ma'am.
Is that the people? Can you intentionally use that as a form of sabotage?
Oh,
I mean,
yeah.
Is it intentional or is it just,
no.
That's just the way I am?
No, it's intentional. They're calling something else, but it's intentional. Yes, ma'am.
It's something that's steeped in their past. That they're so immature.
So either
they haven't grown up or something.
Either they have a history or there's something that there's inadequacy in them. Okay, so either they have a history where they dealt with the same person over and over again, or there's a new incident that took place. Okay, I got need a mic over here. So y'all can see I probably won't get past the slide, right? but as we go, you're gonna see that you. Do it too. Okay? Hold on a second. You got to see that we do it too. But as Christians, we want to stop doing it. Okay? Because the scripture says we're supposed to be honest towards our brothers and sisters. Okay?
Right, yeah. That's exactly what I was going to say. We do it too.
Yeah. Yeah. We do it. All right.
So would sarcasm fall into that? You know how you tell somebody, yeah, you look real good today, but they look terrible, and you're trying to be funny.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
Yep.
And so that's a form of selfishness too, isn't it? Because I want you to act the way I want you to act.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So this is what I'm going to do, correct?
This is what I'm going to do. I got it planned. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
So with all this being said, Pastor, can I presume that sometimes we get so upset about because they did us before we could do them?
Uh-huh. Ooh! Say it again. Say it one more time.
I said that, is that a reason why we get so upset about it? Because they did it before we could do them.
Uh-oh. Ooh. See, nobody want to talk about that. Thank you, Tyrone, for bringing that up. All right, so you need $100 for the bill. And you know the bill has to be paid by 2 o'clock. They stay out until 1:45. It takes 30 minutes to get downtown. They give you a stack of cash. How much you need? You make it to the counter. You broke every speed limit that was available. You get to the counter, and you got $99. They recounted it, and they told you, I counted it. Honey, you sure? You sure it's 100? Now, there, you live with them, and you all's lights are going to get cut off if you don't have $100. How bad do they want to sabotage you? They give you $99. They living in the same house you living in. Your lights get cut off. Now, you going to say that makes sense to you? When it's the flesh, it don't have to make sense. You promised to be on time. You got the car. Y'all talked about this. But you show up late. Hold on. Anybody ever had that done? And they run in the house? And they run in the house and they know it's too late. You promised that we would talk about this action. We're going to talk about it in an hour. Hour come, hour pass. What happens in that hour? 2 hours? 3 hours? Then you go and you bring it up, and then what happens? Give it a mic.
I thought you said you were going to talk to me in an hour. Where you been?
You said that you would cover that, so I relax and spend my money on something else, only to find out that the bill didn't get paid. But you made sure that I spent all my money. Now, you had a question?
I got a question, more of a statement, but that's sowing a bad seed. So... Mm-hmm. See, you're so busy doing bad, then when something terrible happens to you, you're going to be looking crazy in the face. Yeah. Why? Because uh-huh. You was acting ugly.
Yeah. But you don't make the connection of that. You don't think about seed time and harvest. All you think about is, I'm going to control that relationship. You're not even thinking about, yeah.
You sow a bad seed, you reap a bad harvest. That's so basic.
To you.
It's kind of like just a sneaky way of getting revenge back on somebody.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I got a mic right here. But I want to see your boldness when you realize you do it.
I just realize a lot.
Okay.
But I tend to do it towards all of my old friends.
Okay.
And I know that I do it towards people. Clearly, like... Let's go back a little bit at the old church.
Okay.
When I had my homeboys and I was out doing, you know, whatever, hanging out with them. And when I started this business and doing what I'm doing, they used to crack jokes on me, right? Oh, this dude, what are you doing? He going to lose everything. All right? In the middle of that, them dudes done been in jail. They done did a whole bunch of stuff. Well, as they mans, they homeboy, they fake homeboy now.
Okay.
But I get them out, but I mess with them. Well, I might take 2 or 3 days to get them out. Okay. Or if I, back then, when I was still straggling the fence going out, well, they used to use their drug dealing money and throw it up in the club.
Okay.
Well, I use my real pay now at that point. And what would happen was now I see him down in the dumps. Why he feeling down in the dumps? I said, yeah, dog, remember when we used to be back here in the days? I got you, peoples. Okay. I got you. But all I'm doing is talking about all this stuff back in the days on purpose to burn them up.
Okay.
And that was so wrong of me because I realized that that's what I was doing to these dudes. You know, they down. So, but I felt some type of way because I watched them do the same thing to me.
Okay.
I would be passive on it and be like, yeah, we peoples. I go pick them up, hang out with them. But as soon as we go out to the club for real, and party, I'm stinging them.
Gotcha. Okay. All right. I appreciate the honesty. You got one right here.
It's kind of like the mentality of I'm going to get you before you get me.
Okay.
Even though technically that person didn't do anything, it's their stuff that they're carrying with them.
Okay. All right. So I'm going to make it to another slide. Two possible causes, Will. Feeling inadequate. Unwilling to commit to something one feels uncertain about in themselves. Follow me? Unwilling to commit to something one feels uncertain about in themselves. Let's say we have a challenge with people following through at church. So you have to depend on the anointing to do it. But you don't show up to do it because you feel inadequate. But you're not doing it in your strength, you're doing it in his. But you will never experience his strength until you do what you can't do. So I've never been a pastor before. So you can step into it, and then as I pastor, he gives me what I need to do the job. But as long as I stay away from pastoring, which he has called me to, I'll never know that I have the ability to do it. So gifts and talents won't be manifested until they are needed. But you stay away feeling inadequate based off how you see yourself. But it's not how you see yourself, it's how he sees you, and you tap into that. Wayne, this your first solo? Okay. This is his first solo. So how did you get to do this?
I got asked to do it.
Okay, all right, Sharon, thank you. Caused a lot of people to grow, all right? And he did it. So when he stepped up there, how did you feel when you were standing right here? Give me your self-talk right here.
I was nervous.
Okay, and nervous said what?
Nervous said, oh, I'm going to be in front of everybody.
Okay.
And everybody could be looking at me.
Okay.
But then I told myself, okay, this is not about me. It's about ministering to God.
Okay.
Ministering. So I said that to take the focus off of myself.
Okay, so you could actually talk to yourself while you're standing up here.
Yes.
Okay, so then when you came up here, what happened?
I went, oh boy.
All right.
But then I said, okay, I'm going to steal myself and just do it.
Okay.
That's what I said to myself.
And then what happened?
I did it.
Okay. So where did the anointing kick in?
Somewhere in the song.
Okay. You see, Hazel, he would have never experienced the anointing if he had stayed right there. But he definitely wouldn't experience the anointing if he stayed right there. You see where he's sitting? There's no anointing there to do what's required up there. The only way he experienced the anointing for up there is when he goes up there. Even right here, he felt nervous and felt like there was no anointing because the anointing was waiting for him to get right here. If you see what I do the same thing every single Sunday. Because the anointing told me, to turn over to Genesis 1. Y'all got me started in all kinds of ways. Genesis 1. Turn over to Genesis 1. Go ahead, Wayne.
I think I mentioned it to Kim and Sharon. It's when you go up there, something takes over. It's different. Like when I was practicing it, it's not the same as when I sung it. Mm-hmm. It doesn't hit it until I stand up there.
You have what you need when you need it. Y'all got Genesis. Hold on. Stay with me. Keep the question. Genesis word said, and the Holy Spirit hovered, and darkness was on the face. Who? Give me an amplified in the message. She said, amen. Who got it? Where it talks about in the earth was without form and void. Okay.
In the beginning, God
prepared, formed, fashioned, and created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and an empty waste, and darkness was upon the face of the very great deep. The Spirit of God was moving, hovering, brooding over the face of the waters.
Okay, I'm going to ask you to recreate that in a second. All right, so Hazel, I'm coming for you with an anointing. Okay? All right, so start again. Go ahead, Miss Betty.
In the beginning, God prepared, formed, fashioned, and created the heavens.
Hazel. Go ahead.
Created Hazel.
Go ahead.
And the earth. The earth was without form and an empty waste, and darkness was upon the face of the very great deep.
So Hazel had no form, no void, did not know what her anointing was, what her life was, what she was supposed to be, what she's been called to. Keep going.
The Spirit of God was moving, hovering, brooding over the face of the waters.
Anointing. Hazel. The Holy Spirit is moving in the congregation, moving, hovering, waiting on faith to be shown. And the moment he sees faith, he locks in. How do we know that? Remember the woman with the issue of blood? He's bumping into all these people. But when she touched, she had faith attached to her touch. And the anointing recognized that, and it stopped in the form of Jesus Christ. So your life is waiting. The Holy Spirit is waiting on your life to make a demand on how you want to grow. Because he's a gentleman, he will not force himself. But you say, I'm ready. I'm ready to grow. I'm ready for this next step. Are you here to question or state? Y'all going to give me five more minutes? Okay.
All right. Does that sort of work like, you know how faith without works is dead? Mm-hmm. Same thing, correct?
Same exact thing. Okay. Same exact thing. There are people here sitting in the seat that won't come up here and sing. The anointing won't manifest itself because they're not singing. There's people in here that don't teach. The anointing won't manifest itself to teach until you come up. Fear of one kind or another. But in order for healing to be exposed, we must identify what the fear is. What is that fear that's causing you to use passive-aggressive behavior as your form of control? It must be addressed in order for the behavior to stop. You guys consider me one of the toughest pastors because I will call you in the office in a minute. Okay. But first, I have to give account to him for the office of pastor. And second, I have to give account to you in heaven for what I did with the sheep. What did I do with the congregation? Did I allow them to keep doing what they wanted to do? Or did I call them to do what he's called you to do? I take that extremely serious. It might not be popular, but it's extremely serious. So you will find out, Christ is our example, you will find out that he called it out. He called it out. Okay? So a fear of one kind or another, and of course we'll ask the Holy Spirit to show us that as we go down. Can I get to one more slide, y'all? Everybody got the cause and effect? So a good way to process this is as you realize you are being passive aggressive, you ask yourself, Holy Spirit, what fear is being manifested? Or what inadequacy is showing up? Guys, I don't just teach this, I live this. So everything that I'm teaching you, I do it. Okay, y'all ready for this? When you have a relationship with a passive-aggressive person, it will feel confused. You will feel confused and frustrated. Give you a perfect example. When you start speaking to Kim was either confused or frustrated, or unless you already knew that that's what she did. Has she did it before?
No, I knew why she was doing it, but I killed her with kindness.
Okay, so you killed her with kindness. So when you start speaking, she wondered what was going on. So whoever you have a relationship who's a passive aggressive, you're going to feel confused or frustrated. Because what just happened? Yesterday we was talking. Today you're passing by me. Yesterday we was having lunch. Oh, here it comes. Go ahead, sister.
What do you do if both of y'all are passive aggressive?
Oh.
Because, like, the other day, me and Corey got into it, and, like, he wasn't holding doors like how he hold doors. Uh-huh. And he said I was being ugly as well. So, yeah.
Okay.
Is that possible to have two?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And who's going to rely more on the flesh and who's going to rely more on the spirit? Because when two passive aggressors kick in, both of them are deciding how they're going to passive aggress each other out. I know that's not a word. They're going to try to decide how can they outdo the other one through their passiveness. But that's why we've been teaching on internal and external conflict. Because at any time, the passive aggressive person can acknowledge and say, you know what, I'm being fleshly. Yeah, I wanted that door to slam you. You know, they can just go there, okay?
That's why you have to forgive them, because otherwise you can keep going back and forth.
You can keep going back and forth.
Like a ping pong, long as you keep it into play. So the thing to do is just forgive it, stop it, and let them keep acting cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs, you know?
But write this down right quick. This is how smart Jesus is. He said, pray for those who despitefully use you. This is the secret of that. Whatever you pray for, you become close to. Whatever you pray for, you become close to. So if I'm praying for you, I will become closer to you because I have a vested interest. That's why people don't want to pray for the people that despitefully use them. They don't know that that's the real reason. Yes, ma'am. You got the mic? Okay.
I was in a relationship with this guy that at the time I didn't, that's before Chosen Generation. Okay. I didn't know. And, I didn't want to go this deep, but he was telling me the story about he was going to help this lady move. Uh-huh. And, you know, oh, he was so nice and he volunteered his time because he had a truck and he was going to help this lady move. And it started out great. But then the next time I talked to him, after he helped her move, he was so angry because she didn't have anything packed up and this wasn't ready and that wasn't ready. He thought he was just going to go in there and get it over with and be done with it. And he had to help her pack and stuff. And, you know, I was listening to him, and I'm like, well, what happened to the guy that was, like, volunteering his time and being so nice? You know, so the signs were there, but I didn't really see them. But this guy, he could pinpoint exactly where he got stuck, if you will, in his childhood because he played baseball, you know, whatever they call the little people that play baseball. And he was the pitcher, and he kept pitching. He kept trying to tell him his arm was hurting, and he couldn't pitch anymore, and they made him pitch anyway. Okay. And, you know, so it's like they wouldn't listen to me. But that was when he was 10.
Gotcha.
He's like 50 at this time. And 40 years, he's still holding on to that,
you know.
And I felt like dealing with him, I was like, maybe I'm crazy.
Okay.
Something, you know, something's not right. Maybe it's me.
Okay. But all right. It's real. All right, so y'all want to write these questions down. It's going to help y'all a lot. It's going to help y'all a whole lot, okay? And remember, when I teach, you don't have to use all the questions. If you just ask one and get the answer, that's enough, okay? Did that really happen? So remember, because the relationship is going to be confused and frustrated. So when a situation happened where you think the person was supposed to help you, the passive-aggressive person, what's going to happen is you need to ask yourself, did that really happen? And guys, stop thinking it and start saying it. Say it out of your mouth. Did that really happen? Second question, was that real? So did Jazz really turn my jacket inside out? I mean, I know I had the jacket the right way. Were they really helping me? If so, why do I feel a sense, a lack of respect towards me? These four questions, 1, 2, 3, 4, that I ask myself. Wait a minute. So if they were really helping me, why do I feel disrespected? Go ahead, Jay.
Aggressive as well.
Oh, yeah.
Because I had the worst encounter at Chick-fil-A yesterday. Okay. And you know you never have a bad experience at Chick-fil-A. You can go all the way to Georgia, all the way to Maryland, and go to each Chick-fil-A, and they're all good.
Okay.
But don't go to the one at Broad and Tuckernuck.
Okay.
Because Corey and I went in there last night, and they said they were out of nuggets and chicken strips. This is not McDonald's. You're not supposed to run out of stuff. You're supposed to say my pleasure and give me what I asked for. Okay. And so they were like, yeah, we're out, and we don't get another shipment till Monday because we're closed tomorrow. And I was like, that's all I eat. And then Corey was like, because he used to work there, so he knows how to play the game. And he was like, well, can we get some coupon cards? And we want this instead of that. And the guy lied and was like, well, we don't have those coupon cards. We only have soup coupon cards. Who wants soup? And so, yeah, and so then he asked somebody else, and the other guy was like, oh, yeah, we have those. So he was, like, being passive because he was mad that we came in at 9:45 and they closed at 10.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. There you go. So, yes. Oh, yeah. Yeah. You can have anybody can be passive aggressive. But I want you to ask these questions. Wayne?
Yeah, I got – so are these the questions that you're asking them yourself or the person?
Oh, no, you don't ask the person. You ask No, 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 no. You asking you those questions about them.
Okay, so if you ask yourself, okay, if you're not at the other person, how do you know if it really happened or not? Because they're not going to, because you just have your thoughts to go on. Right?
Okay, so
your suspicions.
What were you feeling when you was over here last week at the skit? You wouldn't turn around. And you wouldn't speak to the people. You told them, go somewhere else. Okay, so somewhere in your life that happened. And when you walked by and you spoke to them and they didn't speak back, you should have asked yourself, did that really happen? Did I really just speak to all that group of people and nobody said anything back? So you're trying to locate what really took place. They don't have to answer that. You're asking yourself. So did I just pass? Did they hear me? Did I say good morning loud enough? So you're questioning yourself to find out what part are you in this. So then, was that real? So, you know, you even look back when you was over here reading. We're talking about a skit that we did last Sunday. And he even looked back at them one time and asking himself, is that real? Were they trying to help me? Or we can skip that one. So why do I feel disrespected? You follow me? Everybody follow me? You got to ask those questions out loud because who's living on inside of you? The Holy Spirit. And he's going to answer. Because you want to minimize, you want to rationalize, you want to put it under the table and all that kind of stuff. Go ahead, Shell. Shell got a head down like Lord Jesus, help me.
I was getting ready to ask, so okay. What am I supposed to do when I find out that, I just got disrespected, but the answer is the forgiveness prayer, so I'm straight.
Okay, I'm going to give you two things. I'm going to give you the forgiveness prayer. Okay, y'all ready? Y'all looking really funny. The nerve of the Bible to say, mark those that cause division. The scripture says, mark those, put a mark on them, those who cause division. Because sadly to say, this won't be their first time. My concern is that it won't be your time. Mark those, that's what the scripture says. Do we need to look it up? Are y'all good? Mark those that cause division. So most of the time, this person just didn't do it to you. They've done it to other people. That's why we're going to get to the place where we are going to call it out. Okay? So Michelle says, the forgiveness prayer as passive aggressive. So I know you're just going to tell me to do the forgiveness prayer. Yes, I am.
You said you're going to, eventually you're going to teach us how to call them out.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
It won't be fleshly, though.
I'll wait for that.
it won't be fleshly. On Thursday nights, we have started to teach on, what were we teaching on Thursday night?
When to look over an offense.
Okay? So if you wasn't there on Thursday, we don't record. So all I'm telling you that part one and two is going, one going on Thursday and one going on Sunday. I'll work with you, Shell. All right? Any other? Yes, ma'am. Okay, I work with you. Okay.
Thank you.
So Spencer and Ed, we're going to start recording on Thursday just so that we can get them the knowledge about overlooking your offense. Okay? Can y'all read that one out loud? go ahead.
That's what I was thinking. I said it's very devious.
Oh.
It's so cutthroat and undercurrent and just evil.
Who in Scripture, in New Testament, other than Judas, was passive aggressive? So I want you to think in terms of when I'm being passive aggressive, I'm just like Judas. And who betrayed Christ? He used both deceit and rebellion. Okay? I got one right here.
It's like that song, Smile in Your Face.
Oh, ooh.
All the time you won't take me.
Okay. Spencer, you got that one? Can you find that one? All right. It's by the OJs. Okay, Spencer's going to see whether he can find it for y'all. Yes, ma'am.
Doing it to. And
okay, say
really
it again.
So have we bypassed the person that we're doing it to, and we're really doing it to God?
Uh-huh. If you want to go that way. That's 2 weeks from now, but yes. Because how are you bringing them glory being passive aggressive? How are you bringing them glory when you're using deceit and rebellion?
Can you explain the mark those who cause division? Do you mean avoid them?
Or it could be a boundary.
Just remember that they did it? Or
yeah, they're a profile. That's it. You create a profile with them, and because they did it a couple times. Mm-hmm. So when they do it a couple times, you really know that, okay, this person is really not going to do the right thing according to three times.
So you know what they're capable of.
Uh-huh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. They're not the person that you're going to depend on. Who else? Somebody else had a hand.
All of that being said,
okay,
then insanity must come into it, right? Because if you're doing the same thing over and over again, then, I mean, if you're doing the same thing to me over and over mm-hmm. again, then I should know that I'm going to get the same result.
Gotcha.
Therefore, I need to try something different mm-hmm. in order to get the different
yeah.
result.
Yep.
Okay.
But see, what you guys need an understanding of is, I see, is the emotion kicks in. Because remember, passive-aggressive works the best in the person you're closest to. That's why we're going with the Judas thing. Because Judas was one of the disciples. He was close to Christ. You're going to see things in Scripture that you've never seen before about how he saw this thing. Megan?
Think through the difference of passive aggressive and boundaries.
Okay. Okay.
So you keep getting invited to do something with someone, and some of those answers of, did that really just happen? Mm-hmm. Or why am I feeling a lack of respect? So I'm trying to create boundaries, but I also think there's a play of passive-aggressive in there,
okay.
too.
Okay, okay. And passive-aggressive on you that's
probably
creating
boundaries? Probably on my response.
Okay.
Of like, so you ask me to do something, but I wait. I give it a full 24 hours to respond.
Okay, okay.
Like, oh, you want to get together this weekend? Is the text I get on Friday night. I wait until Saturday night, okay. Sunday morning to say, oh, sorry.
Okay.
Busy.
Okay. All right. Okay.
Frowny face.
We say the frowny face helped out.
Like, oh, sorry. Can't make it.
Okay.
So sad.
Yeah.
But really, I'm not sad. Yeah. Like. And so sometimes I pass that off as I'm creating a boundary. Like, no, I'm not going to spend time with you.
Okay.
But I'm also knowing that I'm waiting till the weekend's almost over.
Okay. All right, so you go back to ask yourself, am I being passive aggressive? That's a question you can ask yourself. Or am I setting boundaries? So the boundary is the quicker the response. The passive aggressive is, I'm going to make them squirm. Check this out. Then I'm going to stop for real. Check this out. The person who is normally late, in their mind, they are saying, Paul to the rescue. Okay, so you're supposed to be here at 10:25 to pray. So at 10:25, we're looking for you and we don't see you. So that's created an issue for us because we're wondering whether you're coming. So we got to decide, okay, well, I tell you what, since we don't see them well, then we'll put you in a place. And I don't see the other person, so we're going to put you in a place. And so now we got the plan. And then all of a sudden they pop in at 10:30. I'm here. Superman to the rescue. Okay? So they have placed an importance on themselves by showing up late because they knew that we needed them to be there. That's passive aggressive. You're sitting in the car talking. It's real stuff. You heard about, I don't know what the term is for firefighters, people who start fires that they put out. Yeah, but it's a certain psychological term they use that they start the fire and they have to put it out. So they solve an issue that they started. But you don't know that they solved the issue because you just think the fire started. So us as Christians, I want us to be aware of when we're being passive aggressive. And the way to know that is just to ask. Holy Spirit, so I could answer that email right now as a boundary, or I could be passive aggressive and wait till the weekend. And we all been passive aggressive. Raise your hand, guys. Y'all been passive aggressive. I've been passive aggressive. We all been passive aggressive. that's why we're here. Because we're going to walk out of that thing, okay? All right, so I'm going to stop right here, really. Let's see, what's the next slide? Wait a minute. Okay. Can y'all give me 5 minutes? 5 minutes? I'm gonna stop. 5 minutes. Can I get 5 minutes, Ed? Can I get 5 minutes? Cause Miss Hampton, I gotta give you a scripture. Okay, I'm gonna give you a scripture. All right, y'all see this one? Look at this. And this my best friend betrayed his best friend. His life portrayed his words. All my life I've been charmed by his speech, never dreaming he'll turn on me. His words, which were musical to my ears, turned to daggers in my heart. Oh. Okay, so play up a little bit. This is a smile on your face all the time. Don't y'all say I'm psych-religious or nothing. Just play a little part, okay? People be talking about you, man. Thank you, Spencer. Thank you. Y'all got it? They got it? You got it? Some of y'all want to get up. Okay, anyway. Right, but check this out. Remember the scripture said, by their fruit you should know them? He said his best friend, his life portrayed his words. Look at Judas. Kissed Christ. Hung around with Christ. Treasure. But his life, his actions betrayed his words. Passive aggressive. This is it in the Amplified. The words of his mouth were smoother than butter, but his heart was hostile. His words were softer than oil, yet they were drawn swords. Man, I got this. I'm going to help y'all. I pick you up. I lend you the money. I help y'all. I'm going to work on you getting the job. Their tongue is a murderous arrow. It speaks deceit. With his mouth, one speaks peace to his neighbor, but in his heart, he lays traps and waits in an ambush for him. How close does your neighbor live to you? And you know they're not just talking about your neighbor. Look who you're sitting beside. Look who you're sitting with. Their tongues were poison arrows. Deadly lies streamed from their mouths. Neighbors greet neighbors with a smile. Good morning. How are things? While scheming to do away with him. Now, I got to stop there. I promise I was going to stop. I want you to think in terms of deceit and rebellion. People trust you. People believe in you. And you're being passive-aggressive on them. I want you to call it out. Start calling it out. All righty? Any questions?
Thank you for joining us today on Challenge to Change, where real transformation begins with you. God bless you.
We invite you to join us every Tuesday at 7 p.m. for His Abounding Grace Show with Minister Vanessa Williams. Every Wednesday at 7 p.m., Challenge to Change, where real transformation begins with you. That's with Pastor Paul Morgan of Chosen Generation Ministries out of Richmond, Virginia. Thursdays, live at 12 noon, join Reverend Pat Randall for Declaring the Finished Work. Reverend Ray and friends are here on Friday nights at 7 p.m. with the Joy of the Lord on Friday Night Joy. Saturdays, Alabaster Box at 7 p.m. with Prophetess Carla Johnson, and Bread of Life with Reverend Ray on Sundays at 7 p.m. For more information, go to our website, www.whenchristiansspeak.com. When Christians Speak Talk Radio is a non-profit ministry. We are dedicated to spreading the gospel of Jesus through our programs and special guests. We exist through the generous support of our listeners. If you are being blessed through this ministry and would like to give a love offering, go to our website and click on our donation page. Your donation will be processed through PayPal. Our prayer is that you may prosper, be in good health, even as your soul prospers.
Unto the Lord, for He is good. Yes, He is good.